Tonight, only on Fox 6, our Mike Lowe brings us the firsthand account of how Lieutenant Brian Murphy and Officer Sam Lenda found themselves confronting evil.
Sunday was just a beautiful sunny day.
The sun was shining, bathing the sick temple in a golden glow, giving no indication of the dark clouds moving in.
It was the kind of day that you don't really mind going to work.
It was Sunday morning, August 5th, 2012. Police Lieutenant Brian Murphy wasn't supposed to be at work that day. The 21-year veteran of the force was filling in for another officer who was attending his son's graduation. At 10:26, the clock changed, and so did everything else.
He went inside the temple.
He's in there shooting people.
Yes, I am. We have to hide now.
Okay, a white male with a gun.
Did anybody get hit?
He's laying in my front yard bleeding.
There's a long drive that goes up towards the temple. I parked right at the, would be the west entrance. And I had saw two individuals down.
Two men lying motionless on the asphalt. The first indication of an unfolding massacre.
Realized pretty quickly that they were deceased, at least in my estimation.
And then there was something that caught Murphy's eye.
The minute he walked out and I caught eye of him, you just knew his movement, everything about him was wrong.
It was white supremacist Wade Michael Page. He had opened fire on peaceful worshipers at the Sikh temple, and now he was gunning for Murphy. Murphy could have retreated to his car and waited for backup. Instead, the Marine veteran, without hesitation, pulled his .45 revolver and confronted a killer.
Part of it was the old saying, he who hesitates is lost. I called from the stop, and that's when he raised his gun, and we both shot pretty simultaneously. Unfortunately, mine missed and his hit.
The first shot hit Murphy in the face.
He hit me right in the chin here, and it went down and destroyed my larynx, and it's now lodged in my neck.
That shot left Murphy with a gravelly whisper of a voice.
I had been standing up, took the shot, and realized, okay, let's get down and get cover.
In video from a camera mounted on the dashboard of Murphy's vehicle, you can see him go down. Off screen, he's taking cover under a parked car. He admits that was a tactical mistake that left him exposed. Page, a former soldier, exploited it and circled around Murphy's back.
He actually flanked me. But again, I gave it a few seconds and I thought, okay, well, he's not coming to my right. Let me stand up and see where he's going. And at that time, that's when I stood up. And he's probably about 6-7 feet just to my rear.
Page fired shot after shot after shot. All in all, he was hit 17 times. 5 plowed into his vest, but 12 of those bullets pierced his body.
I just thought, when is enough enough? Have you not shot me enough times?
The men were 6 feet and a world apart.
He never got close enough, and I don't know why. The next to last shot was the one that he hit me in the back of the head with. I just thought to myself, I'm not going out like this. There's not enough for you, and there's not enough bullets. You're not taking me.
In the distance, Murphy heard the faint sound of sirens.
I know someone's coming.
Page and Murphy exchanged almost 20 rounds, but no words.
There was nothing. He didn't seem enraged. He didn't seem overly excited. It was almost business.
It seemed like hours to Murphy, but backup had arrived just 2 minutes after Page first started firing. Arriving on the scene was the best marksman on the force, Officer Sam Lenda.
I'm one of our members of our SWAT team. I'm a firearms trainer. Training kicked in, and it was every round that the city ever paid for me to shoot and to practice with, came through that day. So when I pulled in, I was kind of startled to see a guy in a parking lot at first, and I thought he was waving at me.
It was soon clear the man was the suspect. He wasn't waving. He was shooting from 60 yards away.
There were things whizzing by my head. I look back at that now and I says, just inches. And for everything he shot at me, he missed. I had just slid off my seat when the round, I was yelling at him when the round hit the window. And I got splattered in the face with the glass.
Stinging but steadfast, Lenda found his rifle and fired a shot that ended the rampage.
Shots fired! Shots fired, officer!
He was not going to get out of that parking lot. If I couldn't get him with a rifle, I was going to run him over with my squad, and if that didn't work, I was going to take him down with my hands, but he wasn't going to leave.
Linda immediately went searching for Murphy, his friend of two decades.
20 years, I remember his children growing up, and I said, that's my partner, that's a battle buddy of mine.
When he found the lieutenant bleeding in the parking lot, Murphy had one message.
These people inside were hurt. Let's take care of them.
He was up on his elbows trying to get up and signal to us, you know, keep going. And
he took that much time to come shoot me, then I know he shot more people.
One of the hardest things I had to do was step over Brian, and that's because that's a trained response we did, not to just reach down, you know, being the first one there wanting to help him. But I knew I had a mission to do.
He had to secure the temple where six worshipers had been killed. Three others were wounded. Murphy was rushed to Frederick Hospital in critical condition. He would spend the next 12 hours in surgery and the next 18 days in the hospital. Murphy pulled through and became an inspirational figure, a symbol of resilience in the distressing aftermath of a mass shooting. He also worried he could become a political pawn in the simmering gun control debate.
What my thoughts really are don't affect the gun debate whatsoever. My answer very completely is, you can make all the measures you want. The Sikh temple shooter would have passed any background check and would have got a weapon.
We should follow the example.
He was invited by President Obama to be a special guest at the State of the Union address. He had been told by White House officials that the president may use his words in the speech.
And I was distinctly told they may not use it. And I thought, that's absolutely fine. So they were actually on the last page of the speech. And I thought, it's never going to happen. But it's still cool to be here.
And then, the climax of the address.
He fought back until help arrived and ordered his fellow officers to protect the safety of the fellow Americans worshiping inside, even as he lay bleeding from 12 bullet wounds. And when asked how he did that, Brian said, that's just the way we're made.
You grew up doing a job that you love to do, and all of a sudden you have the President of the United States quoting you. You know, it's always the opposite. So it was overwhelming, really. And what kind of legacy is that?
The legacy is one of unblinking bravery in the face of overwhelming danger. He and Linda have been honored as Citizens of the Year in Oak Creek and Hometown Heroes by the state legislature.
That's emotional.
But both bristle at that word, hero.
I think the term hero somehow has changed meaning over the last 20 years, 30 years.
You realize that when you go to the funerals of officers who have fallen, those are heroes. Those are the real heroes.
One of the reasons why I shy away from it is because you talk to Sam. If Sam was first, he would have did what I did.
You know, we're lucky. I'll just say, hero, no, lucky, yeah.
Murphy will likely never return to the force because of what he calls his physical limitations.
I was laughing the other day because the dog was running and I yelled stop and he didn't hear me. And I just thought, well, how can you go back to work and yell stop police and, you know, barely you can hear me. It just wouldn't work out.
Murphy is physically weakened.
You know, the shot came in here and broke the bottom of the thumb.
But both men are somehow spiritually stronger.
It instilled my faith in something greater. There's evil that is among us, and we confronted evil that day.
I'm fortunate. Other than losing the tip of my thumb, I'm whole. And more importantly, the inside of me is whole.
It is certainly not easy reliving the Sikh temple shooting, but Murphy says he doesn't dwell on the tragic parts of that day. He says he chooses instead to look at the good that came out of it, in particular, how the event brought the Oak Creek community closer together. Back to you.
And that it has done. I'm just struck by the words, that's how we're made. No, not everyone is made that way.
Right.
Very few people are made that way, and two guys who were made that way were there that day. Thank goodness.
Yeah, the training, the tenacity, and just their spirit, you know, and it just brought tears to my eyes. We're proud.
We wish them continued success in whatever they do, and thank you for all the officers out there who do that
Absolutely.
And would have done that.
Yeah, great piece. Mike, thank you.